Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello everyone, welcome to the paper Developmental Biology. Today's topic is cleavage, blastula and fate maps. I am Dr. Priya Goyal, Assistant Professor, Department of Zoology, Deen Dayal Upadhyay College, University of Delhi. This is the syllabus of Developmental Biology that we are following. And today we are going to discuss the planes and patterns of cleavage, the types of blastula and the fate maps. So in today's lecture, we are going to discuss what is meant by cleavage in embryonic development, what determines the pattern of cleavage in a fertilized egg, the various planes and patterns of cleavage, the different mechanisms the cleavage processes follow, the different forms of blastula, the fate map and its significance, and the different ways of establishing fate maps. First, let us begin with the planes and patterns of cleavage. So students, what do you mean by the term cleavage? After fertilization, the egg divides by a number of divisions, which are known as cleavage or segmentations, to form a solid ball-like structure, which is known as morula. Now the morula soon develops a cavity known as blastocyst, and the next developmental stage so formed is called blastula. So all these series of rapid mitotic divisions which the zygote or the fertilized egg has to undergo so as to convert it into a multicellular form are known as cleavage or segmentation. In between these mitoses, there occurs no growth phase. The blastomeres become progressively smaller and smaller with divisions. The nucleocytoplasmic ratio for each resultant cell increases, and the oxygen consumption during these mitotic cycles remains quite high. It was Aristotle who first of all identified the holoblastic and meroblastic cleavage patterns, followed by Swammerdam, who first observed cleavage in frog's egg. Spallanzani in 1780 described the first two cleavage planes in toad's egg. It was Prevost and Jumos in 1828 who first studied cleavage in reptilian egg. This diagram shows the development of a human embryo from fertilization to implantation. Here we see that after ovulation, the egg comes into the fimbriae of the oviduct. Soon it gets fertilized. After fertilization, the fertilized egg has to travel all through the oviduct to reach its implantation site in the uterus. And during this passage through the oviduct, the fertilized egg is first converted by cleavage or the rapid mitotic division into this solid ball of mass known as morula, which is then converted to blastula. In humans, the blastula is known as blastocyst, and ultimately it gets itself implanted in the uterus. Let us discuss first what factors determine the pattern of cleavage in a fertilized egg. The first and foremost factor is the amount and distribution of yolk present in the egg cytoplasm, which determines where the cleavages can occur and also what relative sizes the next blastomeres will have. In general, yolk inhibits cleavage. Cellular divisions occur faster in the animal pole, which is relatively free of yolk, as compared to the vegetal pole, which is laden with yolk. Also, the zygote nucleus is displaced more toward the animal pole. The second important factor is the angle of the mitotic spindle and timing of its formation during cleavage. The plane of division is generally formed at right angle to the axis of mitotic spindle. As we can see in the diagram showing the planes of cleavage in the first three divisions in the sea urchin, when the mitotic spindle is horizontal, the cleavage plane is vertical. And when the angle of mitotic spindle is vertical, the cleavage plane is horizontal here. So we have four major planes of cleavage. Considering this is a hypothetical egg, this is the animal pole and this is the vegetal pole of this egg. The plane of cleavage, which is passing through the center of the egg, from the animal to the vegetal pole, is known as meridional plane of cleavage. This is seen in the first and second cleavage of frog and also in the first cleavage of chick. Any other vertical plane of cleavage which is not passing through the center of the egg, that is little left or little right to the meridional axis, is simply known as vertical plane of cleavage, as seen in the third cleavage in chick. Then there are certain horizontal planes of cleavage. The horizontal plane of cleavage which is passing through the center of the egg, just like equator, is known as equatorial plane of cleavage, as seen in the third cleavage of sea urchin. Any other horizontal plane of cleavage which is not passing through the center, but little up or little down the equatorial line, is known as latitudinal or transverse plane of cleavage, as seen in the fifth cleavage of frog. So we have different patterns of cleavage also. On the basis of amount and distribution of yolk, the pattern of cleavage can be called holoblastic, which further can be of equal and unequal types. And second is meroblastic, which can further be of discoidal and superficial types. On the basis of plane of cleavage furrow, the patterns of cleavage can be radial, bilateral, spiral, in which we have dextral and sinistral, and rotational. On the basis of fate of germ layers, the pattern of cleavage can be a determinate or an indeterminate one. Let us begin with the first pattern of cleavage, that is based on the amount and distribution of yolk. In this, the first category is the holoblastic plane of cleavage. In holoblastic, each cleavage furrow completely divides the entire egg, as the name says, holos means complete. And this type of cleavage occurs in the eggs which have moderate or less amount of yolk. In holoblastic, we further have an equal type of holoblastic cleavage, in which each cleavage furrow will divide the egg completely, so that the blastomeres so produced are of equal size. Equal holoblastic cleavage is seen in the alacethal eggs, as in eutherian mammals, and also in the microlacethal eggs, as in amphioxus and echinoderms. The second type of holoblastic cleavage is the unequal one, in which unequal sized blastomeres are produced. Now in this, the first and second cleavage furrows are laid similar to the holoblastic equal cleavage. The difference lies in the third cleavage furrow, which is latitudinal. That is, it does not divide the blastomeres right from the equatorial plane, but it is little latitudinal, slightly above the equator. Because of this, there are formed two tier of cells. The upper tier of cell consists of the smaller micromeres, and the lower tier of cells consists of the larger macromeres. This happens because of more concentration of yolk in the vegetal hemisphere, as we know that yolk impedes the cleavage furrow to pass through it. This is seen in mesolacethal and moderately telolacethal eggs, as in some bonifacials and amphibians. These animations show the difference between equal holoblastic and the unequal holoblastic cleavage. The first two cleavage planes will be same in both the cases, that is meridional, which divides first blastomere into two equal, and the second meridional also cleaves the two blastomeres into four equal number of blastomeres of equal size. The difference lies in the third cleavage plane. Now here we can see in equal holoblastic cleavage, the equatorial plane is dividing the four blastomeres into two tier of cells, the upper and the lower, which are of same size. So we have eight blastomeres divided into two tiers of four upper and four smaller cells, and they all have got same size. But in unequal holoblastic cleavage, the third plane, as we see here, is not passing through the equator, but it is latitudinal, slightly above the equatorial plane, which divides the cells into two tiers, the upper tier of four smaller micromeres and the lower tier of four larger macromeres. The next type of cleavage based on the amount of yolk present is the meroblastic cleavage. Meros means part. This happens in macrolacethal eggs, in which a large amount of yolk occupies most of the space. In meroblastic cleavage, the cleavage furrow does not divide the egg completely. That is, only partly division will happen. And the divisions are restricted only to a small cytoplasmic part of the egg. The first type of meroblastic cleavage is the discoidal cleavage, which is seen in highly telolacethal eggs of fishes, reptiles, birds, and monotremes. Here, as we can see in the diagram also, most of the egg cytoplasm is covered with yolk, leaving only a small disc-shaped active cytoplasm at the animal pole. Now, further cleavages can happen only in this disc-like area on the animal pole, producing all the blastomeres which are accumulated at the animal pore only, while the whole of the cytoplasm that contains yolk remains undivided. Animation showing the discoidal metaplastic cleavage, as happens in the highly telolecithal eggs of birds, reptiles, and some fishes. In these eggs, as we see, the cleavage is happening only in the blastodisc present in the animal pore, resulting in the formation of discoidal segmentation. Whereas the rest of the cytoplasm, which is heavily laden with yolk, remains unaffected during this cleavage. The second type of metaplastic cleavage is the superficial cleavage, which occurs in the central lecithal eggs of insects. In the central lecithal eggs of insects, the nucleus is surrounded by a small layer of cytoplasm. Then a complete layer of yolk all over the cytoplasm, which is followed by a thin layer of cytoplasm just in the periphery. So in superficial metaplastic cleavage, karyokinesis is not followed immediately by cytokinesis. This nucleus will divide a number of times to form a large number of nuclei, which are all residing in a single cell, which is now known as syncytium. Now these nuclei will move into the periplasm or the peripheral cytoplasm of the egg, where they come to be known as energids. And this type of blastoderm, in which a large number of nuclei are present without any cytokinesis happening, is known as syncytial blastoderm. Now soon the cleavage furrow will start developing between these nuclei, but these cleavage furrows will not be able to extend beyond the cytoplasm in the peripheral layer because of the yolk present all over. And this stage is known as cellular blastoderm. In this diagram, we can see the discoidal metaplastic type of cleavage occurring in a zebrafish egg. The first diagram shows a one-cell stage embryo, on the top of which at the animal pole, we can see a small layer of blastodisc or the cytoplasm. Cleavage starts in this blastodisc area only to form two-cell stage, then four-cell stage, and then the eight-cell stage, then 32-cell stage, and ultimately the 64-cell stage. And here also we can see that the blastodisc is present on the top of the yolk cell as a separate unit. Moving ahead, let us discuss the patterns of cleavage based on the plane of cleavage furrow. Here we have the five type of cleavage patterns, which are seen mostly in the zygotes with relatively little yolk, that is in isolecithal and mesolecithal eggs. And these isolecithal and mesolecithal eggs cleave holoblastically, in which the cleavage furrow divides the egg completely. So we can say there are several types of cleavage symmetry which are seen actually in the holoblastic cleavage. That is the radial, spiral, bilateral, rotational, and displaced radial. Starting with the first, the radial pattern of cleavage. The radial pattern is the simplest one, in which successive cleavage furrows cut straight through the center of the egg at right angles to each other, such that the blastomeres at the end have got radial symmetry. Means the upper tier of blastomeres come to lie exactly upon the blastomeres of lower tier in a symmetrical manner around the polar axis, as we saw in equal holoblastic cleavage also. This happens in case of echinoderms and amphioxus. Next is the spiral type of holoblastic cleavage, which is characteristic of annelids, mollusks, and flatworms. Actually, it happens in all the protostomes. In this, we see that it is the difference which lies in the third cleavage plane. So the third cleavage plane occurs after the first two successive meridional cleavages. And during the third cleavage plane, the spirally cleaving embryos, that is at the four-cell stage, the plane is not parallel or perpendicular to the animal-vegetal axis of the egg, but formed at oblique angles, forming a spiral arrangement of the daughter blastomeres. And in successive cleavages, the mitotic spindles are arranged in a sort of spiral. Now the turn of spiral may be clockwise, that is right-handed or dextral, or anti-clockwise or left-handed or sinistral. And this turn is controlled by cytoplasmic factors in the oocyte, again a maternal effect. The blastomeres are so closely adhered to each other during this spiral cleavage that there is very small or no blastocele formed between them. And thus, the blastula will be called a stereoblastula, as we will study further. The third type of holoblastic cleavage is the bilateral cleavage. Now, the tunicates show bilateral holoblastic cleavage generally, which has the characteristic feature that the first cleavage plane establishes the plane of symmetry in the embryo, separates the embryo into future right and left sides at that very time only. Further, each successive division will be oriented to this plane of symmetry so that the half embryo formed on the left side of the cleavage plane will be exactly the mirror image of the half embryo formed on the right side. The fourth type is rotational cleavage. Rotational cleavage is characteristic of mammalian eggs only, though it is also seen in nematode eggs. In rotational cleavage, the two blastomeres divide in different planes. The first cleavage will be meridional, but during the second cleavage, first blastomere will divide meridionally, while the other one will rotate and it will divide equatorially. That is, an asynchronous cleavage will happen here. After the third cleavage, there occurs phenomenon of compaction in mammals. The fifth type of cleavage plane here is the displaced radial cleavage, which is seen in amphibians. So the mesolecithal eggs of amphibians undergo displaced radial cleavage, in which the first two cleavages are meridional, but the third cleavage is not equatorial. In fact, it is latitudinal, slightly up the equator, as we saw in the unequal holoblastic cleavage. So that after third cleavage, though the upper tier of cell lies exactly upon the lower tier, but it consists of smaller cells known as micromeres, and the lower tier of cells is constituted of larger cells called macromeres. We will see this in detail when we will study the unit of gastrulation in Xenopus frog in the next lecture. This diagram shows the early cleavage in radial pattern and in the rotational pattern. The radial pattern is seen in echinoderms and amphibians. Here we see that the first cleavage plane and the second cleavage plane both are meridional and both are at right angles to each other. Whereas in rotational cleavage, we see that the first cleavage plane is meridional. Now there is difference in the second cleavage plane. The second cleavage plane in one of the blastomeres is again meridional, but in the second blastomere, it happens to be equatorial. So that an asynchronous type of cleavage is happening here. This diagram shows the two types of spiral cleavage patterns. As we discussed, in the spiral cleavage patterns, the angle of mitotic spindle is neither parallel nor perpendicular to the animal vegetal axis. Rather, it is formed at oblique angles. Now, when cleavage will occur through these kind of blastomeres, the resultant blastomeres will be arranged in a spiral pattern. And the direction of this spiral pattern, if it is left-handed or clockwise, then this cleavage pattern will be known as a dextrospiral one. And if the direction of spiral formed in the blastomeres is right-handed or anti-clockwise, then it is known as a sinistral type of spiral cleavage pattern. And the same is responsible for the direction of coiling in the shell of the mollusks. The third type of cleavage patterns are based on the fate and potency of blastomeres. The cleavage patterns are named determinate and indeterminate. In determinate cleavage, the fate of early blastomeres is fixed. That is, the early blastomeres are predetermined to form specific organs in the embryo. That means the egg consists of a mosaic of blastomeres which are fixed to form different organs in the embryo, because of which the egg is known as mosaic egg. Any blastomere removed experimentally will lead to formation of a defective embryo. That is, the type of development that these mosaic eggs follow is a non-regulative type, as is seen in case of nematodes, annelids, mollusks, and ascidians. In indeterminate type of cleavage, fate of early blastomeres is not fixed. All the blastomeres have the potency to form any organ in the embryo. Any blastomere removed experimentally in the early stages does not lead to the formation of any defect in the embryo. Such type of egg is called regulative egg, which follow regulative type of development, as seen in echinoderms and vertebrates. Here we have certain examples of the early cleavage stages in different animals. The first diagram, as we know, is the plane of cleavage in the first three divisions in the sea urchin, which forms equal sized blastomeres. The first two cleavages here are the meridional, which are formed, of course, here perpendicular to the angle of mitotic spindle. The third is equatorial, forming two tier of cells, the upper blastomeres and the lower blastomeres, which form radial symmetrical pattern around the polar axis. The lower diagram shows bilateral symmetry in the egg of the ascidian tunicate styla partita. Here we know that for me there is this bilateral form of symmetry which is shown here. The very first cleavage determines the bilateral symmetry pattern, and all the subsequent cleavages occur with respect to that first cleavage pattern. This is an example of cleavage in the early stages of a xenopulse egg. The first cleavage is occurring here, and before the first cleavage completes through the vegetal hemisphere, where there is a large amount of yolk present, which impedes the completion of the first cleavage, the second cleavage furrow already begins to draw down. And the third cleavage is not equatorial but latitudinal, because of which there is two tier of cells at the 8-cell stage. The upper blastomeres are known as the smaller micromeres and the lower macromeres. Subsequent divisions in these lead to the formation of morula, and then there is formation of blastocele in between and establishment of blastula. This is an example of the early cleavage stages in case of chick egg. Here we see that the divisions are meroblastic, discoidal in nature, which occur in the small area or the disc of cytoplasm present around the animal pole. Subsequent cleavages form the blastula also at this disc here, as we can see in these diagrams also. We'll discuss the chick egg in the next lectures also in detail. So the cleavage patterns follow certain laws, and the first law of cleavage was given by Sack in 1877, which states that the cells tend to divide into two equal halves unless the yolk is unevenly stored in them. Of course, yolk impedes the process of cleavage through it, because of which the two equal halves cannot be maintained, and it leads to formation of unequal blastomeres, as we saw in the previous slides also. Each new cleavage plane intersects the preceding one at right angles, and this happens to maintain the spheroidal nature of the blastomeres. The second law was given by O. Hertwig in 1881, which states that the nucleus and mitotic spindle occupy the center of protoplasmic density of the egg or blastomeres in which it lies. That is, the spindle prefers to lie along the longest axis of the protoplasmic mass. No wonder, in the microlecithal and isolecithal eggs, the spindle is located centrally, while in a telolecithal ovum, where most of the vegetal pole is covered with yolk, the spindle is formed near the animal pole. Also, the cleavage divisions cut the protoplasmic mass at right angles. The third law was stated by Balfour, which states that the rate of cleavage is inversely proportional to the amount of yolk present, because of which we see in telolecithal eggs, blastomeres at the animal pole divide faster, where yolk is present in quite less quantity as compared to the blastomeres present near the vegetal pole, which are heavily laden with yolk. The fourth law was given by Flücher, which states that the spindle axis elongates in the direction of least resistance. Next, we come to the mechanism of cleavage. So, cleavage consists of two coordinated cyclical processes which follow each other. The first being karyokinesis, which involves the division of nucleus, of course, by the formation of mitotic spindle, which is followed by cytokinesis, which means the cytoplasmic division. Here, it is important to note that an insect egg, which is centrolecithal in nature, we saw that karyokinesis is not immediately followed by cytokinesis. And this helps in the development of syncytial blastoderm during the cleavage processes. Now, during cleavage, the mitotic spindle and contractile ring form perpendicular to each other. The contractile ring bisects the mitotic plane by forming a cleavage furrow. The cortical cytoplasm of the egg contains actin microfilaments, which tighten to form a contractile ring, and this ring creates force for dividing the fertilized eggs into blastomeres. There is an increase in nuclear material while there is no increase in cytoplasm. Hence, the nucleocytoplasmic ratio of the resulting blastomeres increases. The nucleolus is not available during the process of cleavage, because of which there is always a limited production of ribosomal RNA and transfer RNA. There occurs synthesis of new proteins and enzymes, particularly those which will be required during the early development of the zygote, like nuclear histones, tubulins, ribonucleotide reductase, and DNA polymerase. The mitosis promoting factor consists of a large subunit known as cyclin B, which however undergoes periodic synthesis and degradation cycles. Cyclin B is encoded by the messenger RNA present in the cytoplasm of the oocyte. It helps in regulating the rapid and synchronous divisions in the cleavage, thereby maintaining the regular cycles of M, that is the mitotic phase, and the S, that is the synthesis, DNA synthesis phase during cell division. So this completes the topic cleavage in the lecture. And next we start with the types of blastoma. As we discussed during the patterns of cleavage, that cleavages form a solid ball-like structure consisting of a cluster of blastomeres known as morula. Soon, narrow crevices appear between the cells of the morula, which coalesce to form blastoma. And this coalition develops a fluid-filled cavity called blastocoele, which underlies the cellular layer known as blastoderm in the blastoma. However, morula is not formed in the central lacethal eggs of the insects. Here, during divisions, the blastomeres adhere by special cell adhesion molecules like EPC adherins, and also by the help of tight junctions. The blastocoele, or the segmentation cavity formed inside the blastula, provides space for the morphogenetic movements of cells during castration. The first type of blastula is the stereoblastula. In stereoblastula, the blastocoele is absent or very much reduced. This type of blastula is seen in case of annelids, mollusks. The second type of blastula is the coeloblastula, which is hollow spherical in nature, containing a fluid-filled blastocoele in the center, which is surrounded by a single layer of blastoderm layer. Coeloblastula is seen in case of echinoderms like sea urchins and amphioxus. The third type of blastula is the amphiblastula, which is seen in amphibians. Amphiblastula is formed from mesolacethal eggs. It is formed as a result of the displaced radial holoblastic cleavage, in which the blastocoele is eccentric in nature. The animal hemisphere consists of micromeres, which form the blastocoele roof, and the vegetal hemisphere consists of the large cells known as macromeres, which form the floor of the blastocoele. Next type of blastula is the discoblastula, which is formed from the macrolacethal, highly telolacethal eggs of fishes, reptiles, birds, and protothlebians. Discoblastula is formed as a result of the discoidal meroblastic cleavage, in which the cleavage process happens only in the disc-like cytoplasm present in the animal whole of the egg, while most of the cytoplasm, which is covered by yolk, remains uncleaved. Now, extensive cleavages only in the disc-like cytoplasm present here results in the formation of discoblastula, in which a multi-layered disc of cells is seen at the animal pole only, with a subgerminal cavity forming here, whereas later on a true blastocoele will appear between the epiblast and the hypoblast. The next type of blastula is the blastocyst, which is a characteristic of mammals. This is a blastula in which we can say that there is formation of the inner cell mass or the embryoblast, which are actually the formative cells which will develop into the embryo proper. These inner cell mass is covered by a layer of trophoblast or trophoectoderm, while enclosing a fluid-filled blastocoele cavity in between. Now, this trophoblast or trophoectoderm has the responsibility to form the extra embryonal membranes as well as placenta. This blastodisc will attach to the uterine wall of the female by trophoblast, which helps it in drawing nutrition for the growing embryo. The last type of blastula that we discuss here is the superficial blastula or the periblastula, which is a characteristic of insects. Superficial blastula is formed by superficial cleavage seen in insect eggs, which leads to the formation of a syncytial blastoderm. As we discussed during cleavage, syncytial blastoderm is the one in which a large number of nuclei are arranged without any division of the cytoplasm. Now, when cleavage will start, it will occur in the peripheral cytoplasm only. The cleavage furrows will not be able to extend into the central yolk-rich cytoplasm or the endoplasm. So this forms a one-cell thick layer of blastoderm around a cavity that is filled with yolk. So virtually there is no blastocele in superficial blastula also. So this completes the different types of blastula. Next we move on to fate maps. As we discussed in the first part of this lecture, during development, a single cell zygote divides multiple times to form a morula, then blastula, then larva in some cases, and finally the adult organism. Now the cells that are formed during successive mitosis will develop into all kinds of tissues and organs in the adult. But which blastomeres or cells form which organ is really difficult to ascertain when studying developmental biology, since all those cells are more or less similar in appearance. So the fate of each cell or the blastomere can be ascertained only when each of them is labeled or marked differently. This only will enable the investigators to follow the movement of blastomeres and draw up certain specific diagrams. So this type of differently colored labels or markings in the embryo when presented in the form of diagrams are known as fate maps. So we can define fate map as a diagrammatic representation of the prospective fate of each part of an early embryo at an early stage of development. In a fate map, the embryonic regions with a distinct fate are called primordia or rudiments. And as during development, the cells multiply and they change their positions with respect to each other, the fate maps also change with time. That is, the fate maps will always indicate changes in the fates of blastomeres at very closely followed stages. These four diagrams show the fate maps of four vertebrates at the early gastrula stage. That is the fate map of zebrafish, frog, chick, and mouse. Here A represents the anterior end and P represents the posterior end of the embryo. All these are the dorsal surface views, and here we can see that despite the different appearance in the adult animals, the fate maps of these four vertebrates show a number of similarities at the early gastrula stage. Here the blue color indicates the prospective ectodermal regions. The pink or the red colors indicate the prospective mesodermal regions, while the yellow color regions indicate the prospective endoderm. So here we can make out that there is this region epidermal ectoderm, which is present in all the gastrula around the animal hemisphere. And this is the region which will form the epidermis of the skin in all the four vertebrates. Next to epidermal ectoderm is lying the neural ectodermal region, as we see again the blue color here with a different tinge. This neuroectodermal region is a small ectodermal region which will give rise to the formation of neural tube and nervous system. Then there is this crescentic area present below the neuroectoderm, which is labeled the notochordal region. So notochordal region, as the name says, will give rise to the notochord of the embryo. And on either side of the notochordal region are present these lateral regions, as we see here, the lateral regions. And these two lateral areas constitute the prospective mesoderm. Then there are the yolky blastomeres at the vegetal hemisphere, which collectively form the prospective endoderm. Here we can see a dashed green line, and this dashed green line indicates the site of ingression, the path the cells will follow as they migrate from exterior of the embryo to the interior during gastrulation. So students, we can say the fate map may be fixed or predictable in nature, in which particular parts of the eggs always contribute to particular parts of the larva or adult. as seen in case of nematodes or tunicates. However, the fate map may be quite unpredictable in nature as seen in case of mammalian embryos. In mammalian embryos, it is difficult to prepare a fate map because they are developing inside another organism. However, there are quite a number of researches which are going on to prepare these fate maps of mammalian embryos also. There are certain important characteristics that a good label or a marker which is used to prepare fate maps should have. A good label should not spread to neighboring cells. That means it should keep itself restricted to the cells it is meant to label. Secondly, it should be readily detectable at later stages also. That is, the label should not get diluted during divisions. Thirdly, a good label should not interfere with normal cell development. That is, it should not hamper any of the important cell processes. There are a number of methods which are used to label the blastomeres to study their fate maps. First of all, it's the direct observation with natural labels. So here we can see that there are certain embryos who have natural difference in pigments in the cytoplasm of their early blastomeres. So when the embryo has few number of cells or the blastomeres and there are already some distinct color differences in those blastomeres with respect to each other, then it becomes possible to directly observe such embryos under microscope and trace the fate of each cell into various organs they are going to generate. As seen in case of the fertilized eggs of some ascidians like Styla, Siona, Cynthia, Edward Conklin followed the fate of each blastomere individually in Styla parteita, a sea squirt, by virtue of the differences in pigment in their cytoplasm. During his study, he observed four distinct regions in the embryo. He found that the clear cytoplasmic cells present at the animal pole developed into ectoderm. The yellow cells formed the prospective mesoderm, that is the trunk muscles. He also assumed that these yellow cells formed the tail during development, which he concluded with his experiment also. The slate gray colored cells always form the endoderm, while the light gray colored cells form the neural plate and the notochord. Now the diagram below shows the fates of individual cells and the drawings which were prepared by Edwin Conklin during his study. In the A diagram, we can see the eight cell stage of the embryo, where two of the eight blastomeres contain the yellow cytoplasm. The B diagram shows the early gastrula stage, showing the yellow cytoplasm in the precursors of the trunk musculature. The C diagram shows the early larval stage, again which shows the yellow cytoplasm in the newly formed trunk muscles. Thus, Conklin concluded that only one pair of blastomeres, which were present in the posterior vegetal location in the 8-cell embryo containing the yellow crescent, were capable of producing the tail musculature. Now students, all the embryos do not have natural color differences. So some artificial markers or labels need to study their progression in development. In 1929, Walter Hoad, an embryologist, while working on amphibian embryo, invented the method of using vital stains or the vital dyes, which help in staining different parts of the embryo. Vital dyes are the ones which stain the embryonic cells but do not interfere with any essential functions. Vital dyes used commonly are Nile blue, Nile red, Janus green, neutral red, and Bismarck brown. However, vital dyes have got a limitation that they become diluted with successive cell divisions. In his experiment, Watt mixed vital dyes with agar and spread the agar on a microscopic slide, allowing it to dry. Then he clipped off this agar into very small chips and he placed those chips on the frog embryo for a short period of time till the dye diffused from the agar onto the frog embryo. Now he could follow those stained cell movements in the embryo to find out their prospective fates. Here as we see, the B to D diagrams are showing the dorsal surface views of the stain on successive later embryos, and the E diagram shows a nude embryo which is dissected in a medial sagittal section to show the stained cells in the interior. Thus, by marking several areas simultaneously with different colors dye, it is possible to continuously follow the movement of stained cells during gastrulation. Cellophane has also been used in place of agar in the subsequent experiments. Another experiment by N. Spratt in 1946 to study cell fate maps included carbon particle mapping. He used carbon particles to demonstrate the process involved in primitive streak formation in chick embryos. He used carbon particles and applied them to the blastomeres, just like what applied agar chips. These carbon particles stick on the cell surface and can be used as markers to trace the fate of blastomeres. But the carbon particles again have the same limitation that they also become diluted with successive cell divisions. Radioactive labels have also been used to study fate maps. For example, the carbon, phosphorus and hydrogen radioactive isotopes have been used. Now, the cells with these markers can easily be studied by autoradiography to trace their fate. For example, the incorporation of tritiated thymidine into the DNA will label the nuclei. And all the cells which are formed after cleavage having the labeled nuclei can easily be then started. During radioactive labeling, a region of interest is cut out from the host embryo and it is replaced by a radioactive graft from the donor embryo. And then the fate of each of those cells can be studied. But these radioactive labels have got their, again, same limitation that they also become diluted with each cell division. Plus, there is always exposure to radioactivity, which is a biological hazard. Histochemical stains have also been used in fate map studies. Histochemical stains include the enzyme-specific staining of the embryonic cells, and these stains can be visualized by adding substrates specific for its enzyme activity. For example, the enzyme horseradish peroxidase, or the HRP, is the one which is most commonly used. Now, these histochemical stains have the limitation that in this we require the embryo to be prefixed for staining. Fluorescent dyes have also been commonly used to study fate maps. Fluorescent dyes are conjugated to carrier molecules and micro-injected into one or more cell. Now, the descendants of these cells also get labeled. The commonly used fluorescent stains are the labeled dextrins and the labeled carbocyanin dyes. That is the dialkyl indocarbocyanin, or the DII, and dialkyl oxocarbocyanin, or the DIO. Both DII and DIO are lipophilic membrane stains, and once injected into a single cell of an early embryo, the descendants of that cell can be seen easily by examining the embryo under ultraviolet light, where the DII will give red emissions and DIO will give green emissions. Recently, microinjections of stable messenger RNAs encoding fluorescent proteins have been used successfully in study of fate maps. The major advantage of these is that they act as quite a long-lasting label. Here we have the fate map of zebrafish embryo using fluorescent dye. In the A diagram, we can see the specific cells of the zebrafish embryo which were injected with the fluorescent dye have been activated with the laser. Now, this activation shows a small region of about 5 cells in the late cleavage stage embryo. After formation of the central nervous system has begun, cells that express the active dye were visualized by fluorescent light. And this fluorescent dye is now seen in particular cells that generate the forebrain and the midbrain. The C diagram shows the fate map of the zebrafish central nervous system. The fluorescent dye was injected into cells 6 hours after fertilization, and the results are color-coded onto the hatched fish, as we see here. So apart from all these kind of labels, there are genetic labels also which are used to study fate maps in different embryos. Now, the genetic labels work by creating embryos in which the same organism will contain cells with different genetic constitutions. The advantages of genetic labels are that these labels will not spread to neighboring cells and they are kind of permanent. And once added to the blastomeres, they are inherited by all the descendants of that marked cell very easily.
However, they have their own limitations, that there is always a kind of low efficiency of introduction of the gene into the cell that we want to label. Genetic labels can be studied by creating chimeric embryos by the process of xenoblastic transplantation, or also the creation of transgenic embryos by using retrovirus mapping. Chimeric embryos are created by xenoblastic transplantation. Now here we see the xenoblastic transplantation of embryonic grafts involves the animals of interest which have different genetic constitution but similar development pattern. For example, the chick quail chimeras were prepared by, first of all, Nicole Lee Durin, who was a developmental biologist. She grafted the embryonic quail cells inside a chick embryo while the chick was still in the egg. LaDurin removed a portion of the neural tube and neural crest from a chick embryo and replaced it with an identical portion of the quail one at the same stage of development. Now, the chicks and quail embryos develop in a similar manner, especially during the early stages. And the grafted quail cells become integrated into the chick embryo very easily, and they help in the construction of various organs. Now, the chick that will hatch will have quail cells in particular sites depending on where the graft was placed. And tracing these cell fates led to understanding the development of nervous systems in higher order organisms. Retrovirus marking is another way to generate transgenic DNA chimeras. In this method of retrovirus marking, there is incorporation of retrovirus engineered reporter genes into DNA of the host cells. Now, the expression of this reporter gene can be studied later by histochemical or fluorescent marking on the gene products, depending on what kind of retrovirus was used initially. A most common method is the alteration of host DNA to express GFP or the green fluorescent protein. As this diagram shows, the neural crest cells in the chick embryo, which are GFP labeled using retrovirus mediated marking. This diagram is a part of the experiment which is showing the development of neural crest cells in the chick embryo. This is the latest technique of creating genetic labels, that is the BrainBow. So this technique is used to label individual neurons in the brain using fluorescent proteins. An array of colors are generated by different expression of distinct fluorescent proteins. This technique was originally developed by Lishman and Sains in 2007 at Harvard University. The diagram here shows a BrainBow of mouse cerebral cortex neurons originally developed by these scientists. So students, finally, we are in a position to describe the details of the fate maps of these four vertebrates, which we will take up when we will study the gastrulation process in the subsequent chapters. So why to study fate maps? Fate maps are an essential tools in studying experimental embryology. That means only if we know what the fate of each cell is, what those cells are going to form, which organs they are going to develop into when they form the adult organism, we can detect or estimate the behavior of each cells, and accordingly we can plan our experiments in embryology. Also, the fate maps help in tracing the cell lineages by following individual cells to know their fate during development. Studying fate maps helps us understand the mechanism of morphogenetic movements during gastrulation. So this completes our topic of fate maps. Now that we are done with the planes and patterns of cleavage, the types of blastula, and also a detailed discussion of the fate maps, students, try to think about these questions. What determines the positions of the cleavage planes? Cleavage involves multiple mitotic events, but many aspects are different from mitosis. Can you highlight those aspects? How can cleavage lead to a hollow blastula with such a clear inside-outside polarity? Also, think, what functions does the blastocele serve? Are fate maps useful in deciphering the fate of embryonic cells? If yes, how? Let us summarize our lecture in a snapshot. Cleavage involves a series of rapid mitotic divisions, during which the zygote is converted into a multicellular form. The planes and patterns of cleavage are essentially a factor of the plane of mitotic spindle as well as the accumulation of yolk in the zygote. Blastula is the embryo with a cavity, and this cavity is known as the blastocene. Isolecithal eggs undergo holoblastic cleavage to form a ceiloblastula. Mesolecithal eggs undergo holoblastic cleavage to form an amphiblastula. Telolecithal eggs undergo discoidal cleavage and form a discoblastula, while the centrolecithal eggs undergo superficial cleavage to form a superficial blastula or the periblastula. Fate maps are the diagrammatic representation of the prospective fate of each part of an early embryo at an early stage of development. They are an essential tool in experimental embryology, studying cell lineages and also the morphogenetic movements during gastrulation. Various natural and artificial labels are used to study fate maps. These are the books which have been referred in preparation of this lecture. Hope you had a good time listening to me. Happy learning.